mama. I know you say you know that's a father. I am more than a traitor. So I look at you, see your fine clothes. Directorate of General Studies Program, DST 104. Another topic. Microbes and Earth. What is microbe? Microbe is single-celled organism, so tiny that millions can fit into the eye of a needle. A microbe is any living thing that spends its life at a size visible sometimes only with a microscope, that is, too small to be seen with unaided eye. If you want to see it, you must use microscope. Microorganisms or microbes play a very important role in our lives. The human gastrointestinal tract is a reservoir for 100 trillion microorganisms. This expanding population of microbes encompasses sometimes between 500 and 1,000 different bacterial species. There are different types of microbes. The first one that I want to talk about is bacteria microbe. Bacteria are single-celled microbes without a cell nucleus. Some bacteria require oxygen to live, while others thrive in low oxygen environments. Some bacteria use light as an energy source, while others use chemicals found in their habitats. Some bacteria are good, while some are bad. The ones that are good can be taken as food, while the bad ones can cause illnesses, can cause diseases. Many of the good bacteria help us metabolize food and fight illness. Those are the good bacteria. Hundreds of bacteria cells live within our intestine, within our mouth, within our skin, which are harmless. Human gut contains bacteria also, and they help us digest and absorb nutrients, play a part in protecting our intestinal walls. Those are the good bacteria. Gut bacteria can also help regulate weight and ward off autoimmune diseases. These bacteria help us to do everything from digesting to recovering from diseases. Another type of microbe is viruses and prions. Viruses and prions. Viruses are microbes that are not actually living cells. When they are outside the cell, they are inactive because they cannot replicate themselves without a host. Before they can be active, they have to be in a host. Viruses can infect many organisms, including single bacteria cells and cells of humans. We are hearing of Ebola now. Virus is virus that is causing Ebola. Where they got the virus is the place called Ebola. That's why they named that virus Ebola virus.
And you know, these are microbes that we cannot see with our naked eyes. That is why we are advised to take absolute cleanliness. Make sure you wash your hands, you clean your hands. This one is cleansing handy wipes that can sanitize your hand to remove the virus. This time of Ebola virus, it can help you to remove this virus from your hand in order not to contaminate you. This is it. Then this the thing you can use. I've taken one out of it, between it. This sanitizer that you can use to sanitize your hand to prevent you from infection, especially this time around Ebola virus. Prions are not living cells. Prions occur naturally within human and other mammalian brains. They are proteins that are sometimes classified under microbes. I mean these prions, because they can cause diseases. They are microbes. Another microbes, fungi. Fungi are microbes that sometimes look like plants. Fungi are microbes that sometimes look like plants. The example, yeast and molds. Yeast used in bread and beer making are examples of fungi. The name that we have as an example is Candida albicans. However, they lack chlorophyll that plants use to convert sunlight into chemical energy. That is fungi, talking about fungi. Example of mold is Aspergillus fumigatus. So this is another type of microbes. They live in Dead Sea. The last time I had, I saw the Dead Sea. I saw it in Jerusalem. Dead Sea. If you taste it, it's salty. And these microbes, they live there. That is the only way you can find aqueous microbes. They live in Dead Sea. Protist microbes can occur either a single cell or a colony of similar cells. They live in water or in moist habitat on land. Anywhere that is you have water around, they can live there. And you have to be very careful. That is why absolute cleanliness must be done. When you go, we are moving around, and when you get home, you clean up. Microbes matter more than you think. You know, I told you earlier on that we have bad microbes and we have good ones. If you hear about microbes, some people may be running away from it. But the good microbes you must embrace. Some microbes gives us beer, wine, cheese, yogurt. Without them, we cannot get these products. Wine, cheese, yogurt. They are good microbes. They are also useful in food or drink produced by fermentation. Without microbes, we cannot get our ogi. You have your maize. You soak your maize for some time to ferment. It's the work of microbes. Even the locust beans that is common in the market for you to prepare your okra or other stew like the melon stew. It is the work of fermentation that makes locust beans to be eatable. That's what Yoruba call the iru. So they are good microbes. Microbes are useful vehicles also for the production of insulin and other life-saving drugs. For people with diabetes, we have insulin injection that they will be taking to heal them of their disease. And these microbes are used to prepare them. So we have good microbes here. Microbes, on the other hand, contribute to stomach bugs, deadly infectious diseases such as tuberculosis and plague. As they are good, also they are bad. Some are bad because they can cause infection, they can cause diseases. I mentioned about Ebola virus, I mentioned about other illnesses that you can further through these microbes. As they are good, in the other hand, they are bad. Microbes are the other constitute of the stomach bugs, deadly infectious disease such as tuberculosis and plague. I repeat. Bacteria and viruses are even linked to certain cancers. Cancer of the cervix and so on. Bacteria from chicken guts can cause food poisoning too, with severe vomiting and diarrhea. Another point is parasites under microbes. Parasites are organisms that live in or on another living being and obtain shelter and nourishment from this host. Parasites are divided into two major groups, protozoa and helminths. Protozoa are single-celled organisms belonging to the animal kingdom with different species. Example, we have Plasmodium species, we have intermembered species, and so on. Helminths are parasitic worms which receive protection and nourishment from their host. We talk about tapeworms, we talk about hookworms in the body of the host, which must be taken care of. Mode of transmission. How do you transmit these microbes? That's what we are saying. Transmission of microorganism or microbes involve movement of the organism from a location reservoir or source into susceptible host through a portal of entry. That's why we are afraid of this Ebola. Transmission is the problem, to transmit from one person to another. That's the problem. We have portal of entry. That's why we want to fight it, so that we can stop this disease in our country, Ebola virus disease. Transmission usually occurs from person to person, as it is referred to as horizontal transmission. That's what is happening about Ebola now, from person to person. Hmm? If you have Ebola and you visit a doctor in the hospital, and the doctor is infected, it's from you to that person. And that person, the doctor can transfer to other patients. Even in the family setup, husband can transfer to wife. The wife can transfer it to the children at home. That is what we call horizontal transmission. If it is vertical transmission, it is when it is transferred from pregnant woman to her unborn baby. You know, it's possible for a woman to transfer a disease to an unborn baby through the placenta. So we have to be very careful of this infection through microbes. There are four methods of transmission of microbes. You can transmit directly, you can transmit indirectly. You can have common vehicle transmission. It can be airborne transmission through the air. It can be vector-borne transmission, that is, through the insects around, mosquitoes, flies, rodents, cockroaches, can transfer it to human being. The common vehicle transmission is from food and drink. You can get it from food, you can get it from drink. That is why you must watch what you eat so that you will not get infection from your food and from your drink intake. Epidemiology. Epidemiology is the study of the occurrence, casualty, and prevention of infectious diseases in the populace, like we are doing to Ebola now. We knew the person who brought the Ebola, that is the occurrence. We know the casualty now, and now we are preventing the infection in order not to spread all over from the populace. That is epidemiology. The occurrence of the infectious disease can be in so many ways. It can be sporadic, that is occasional occurrence. It can occur occasionally. Endemic, there may be regular or continuous occurrence. It can be epidemic, significantly increased occurrence. As you treat it, it will be increasing. That's epidemic. That is why we are stopping this terrible disease of Ebola in Nigeria, so that it won't spread over significantly. Pandemic, occurrence in multiple countries. And this Ebola has started that. You had it in Liberia, you had it in Senegal, you had it in Nigeria and so on. So we want to make sure that all these diseases will not affect the populace. Control of infection. If you are infected, how do you treat it? If you are not infected, how do you control the infection? It is important to control microbes and the infectious diseases that they cause. Control of infections begins with making an accurate diagnosis. You know, if they don't diagnose that man called Sawyer who brought Ebola to Nigeria, they won't know the type of disease and they won't know how to treat it. The first thing, if somebody is ill, is to diagnose. You know the type of disease, then you treat the disease, and also you ensure that further infection will be prevented. That is, you prevent further infection after diagnosing, you treat, then you prevent further occurrence. Treatment of infections aim to clear the microbe causing infection and to relieve symptoms associated with such infection. So we should treat it well. If you have any problem with your health, the first thing you should do is to visit a doctor. Let the sample be taken, then they diagnose and know the illness, the type of illness, and now they know how to treat it. After treating it, they ensure that infection will be prevented. You will not be able to spread it around, like in a family setting. The doctor will tell you how to cope with the illness so that it will not spread to others. Preventive measures should be taken to prevent infection and the reoccurrence of the infection. That is what we are doing for the Ebola virus now. If we don't do that for this Ebola virus, so many people will have died of this Ebola virus in Nigeria. But we thank God that we are able to know the type of the virus and to know how to treat those people that have that virus and to stop spreading this terrible disease called Ebola. What you can do to prevent this infection also, hand hygiene. I've showed you this before, that you can use it to clean your hands regularly, and also hand washing is useful. This is hand sanitizer. We use soap, that is the liquid soap with clean water, to wash your hands and dry it properly. And if you the person moving around, maybe you go to your offices or you go to the market or you go to church, you come back, use this hand sanitizer to clean your hands so that it will remove the microbes that might be in your hands. Another thing is healthy practices. You have to practice good hygiene. You have to eat balanced diet. You have to avoid overcrowding. Overcrowding can spread diseases. If too many people are in a room, sleeping together, doing everything together, or in a class, overcrowding, that one will encourage the infection to spread to so many people. Another point is vector control. I told you about mosquito, about rodents, about cockroaches, about flies. Don't allow them in your house. Control them. Like you know, you have stagnant water around your house that can breed mosquito. Just make sure you remove or clean that place and make sure the environment is neat. There is Plasmodium that can cause malaria if my mosquito bites you. There is one who can cause sleeping sickness if sassafras fly bites you. So you have to know how to control that in your environment. What of rodents like rats and mice around your house? Make sure you observe absolute cleanliness. Don't allow mosquitoes, flies to enter your house to carry unnecessary infection to your family. Food safety is another important thing. Prevent your food from contamination. Don't let microbes contaminate your food. As you buy from the market, when you get home, the first thing you do to whatever you buy from the market is wash. With what? Clean water. Wash thoroughly with clean water before you start preparing the food. And anything you want to cook, make sure you make sure that it's very clean after.